tinfoil hat. Trust the science, bro. All right, well, what about my eyeballs? What about what I'm looking at?
I can go to the moon in a nanosecond. The problem is we don't have the technology to do that anymore.
You can tell it's real because it looks so fake.
Space Force.
We still have comedy, though. We still have great comedy out there. There's always rambling Joe Biden.
Come on. This guy is a dog whistle about as big as a foghorn.
I don't like him putting chemicals in the water that turn the friggin' frogs gay.
Oh, boy. Say, do you want to go inside my clubhouse? I charge $50 for a hot dog.
Well, you know, the aliens could be showing up any day now.
Dude, this guy's an alien.
NBC News has learned that disgraced financier Jeffrey Epstein is dead.
You won't release the Epstein list, so you're going to freaking imprison Andrew Tate.
You're living in the Matrix, man.
There is no spoon.
Here's the one.
I represent science.
You will owe nothing, and you will be happy.
Hack human beings to go under the skin.
See, I have allergies. Good.
I like turtles.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to the podcast. Today I got the legend on. Everybody knows him. Everybody loves him. Lane Kendall, how you doing, buddy?
What's up, dog? How's it going?
Dude, it's going fantastic.
Got your Bud Light ready to go?
I got my Bud Light seltzers chilling like a villain. Yeah, dude. I got a wig ready, too, right after I drink it. What do you think of all that crap? Anyways, like, what do you think of it?
It was the dumbest marketing decision in the history of marketing decisions. Like, Bud Light is the white trashiest of all the beers, and I can't imagine, like, nothing wrong with that. I've enjoyed a couple good Bud Lights in my day, but I can't imagine the thought process of the marketing team that decided that that was a good idea. So, you know, good riddance to them.
What are they down, like, 30% in sales?
Like 20 to 30, depending on the region, from what I've seen. Like, and it's a month out, so I'm actually kind of surprised to see how much staying power this boycott has had. But that, I don't think anybody really likes that Dylan Mulvaney person.
Who would like that person, dude? That person's a fucking idiot.
Yeah.
Not only that, they're just like, I don't know, they're just retarded. I don't know. I don't know what to think of all the trans stuff. It's weird how Target has like a section now, and like all these stores have sections with kids trans, you know, I'm trans and proud. And what is it? A global contagion? Isn't that what you said? Or a
social, social contagion.
That's it.
Yeah. It's just, yeah. I mean, you look at the historic data. First it was 2% and then 10% and then 15% and then 20%. And it's in very specific areas of the country that this is happening. So, I mean, Bill Maher talked about it. He made the point that, I don't know if he was comparing Ohio to Beverly Hills. He's like, why is the trans thing a problem in Beverly Hills and not Columbus, Ohio? Right. So,
yeah.
It's, yeah. There are obviously people that are affected by some sort of gender dysphoria or some sort of mental hang up. And that's, you know, they should have sympathy. And we should, but to say that one out of five people is all of a sudden, that is just insanity.
Is that the statistic they're saying?
They're saying 20% identify as some sort of LGBTQ plus /backward/divided by sign or whatever. But that if that was how humanity worked, then we would never be able to reproduce if one out of five of us decided that we were just not going to be, you know, regular sexual reproducers.
That's what like comes to my mind when I think about this stuff, because I'm like, how long can this movement really last? Because the people who are behind it will not reproduce.
Well, that's, I mean, we don't really have to get into this today because it's not really my area of expertise. But obviously, you look at who's having children, it's religious people, conservative people, people with more traditional values. And the people that aren't having kids are the liberals, the people that say global warming is going to kill us all. But they still have to have control over the next generation. But they're not having kids. So what do they have to do? They have to basically indoctrinate kids through school. That's why they go into education, because they're not having kids. So they have to take your kids and indoctrinate them. And then immigration, bring in people that will vote for them because they'll give them free shit. And this isn't to say, and it doesn't make a lot of sense, because a lot of these people that want to come to the U.S. are not inherently liberal in any sense of the word. But as soon as one party's like, yeah, we're going to give you a bunch of free stuff, it's hard not to want to vote for them. That's just human nature. Until it, you know, but people from Venezuela, people from Cuba might vote a little differently. But either way, we'll get to the immigration stuff in a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah, we will. Yeah, so, I mean, we're going to totally switch subjects. I just got two root canals this week. You've never... Yeah, I know, right? Isn't that dope?
Yeah.
Have you ever had a root canal?
No, I've never had major teeth problems. I've always had like little cavities here and there. And nothing that's... I had my wisdom teeth taken out, which was terrible. But I've never had... I've been really close to a couple root canals, but then they decided that they could just go ahead and fill the cavity. So I guess we're good to go for now. But I have cavities all the time.
Yeah, I wonder about my cavity issue, and... I know why I had the root canals, because I chewed tobacco for a long time, and then didn't go to the dentist for a long time, and then that's what happens. It even says it on the can, can prevent will cause tooth loss. At first, when I was chewing it, I was like, yeah, whatever, I'm 21, I'll be fine, but it catches up to you. But I've quit tobacco for 3 years, so I'm doing good. But
are you on that Zimbabwe now?
I'm on that Zimbabwe, that Zen life, but. It sucks getting a root canal. Anybody listening who has had one, it's like the only thing, it's not that bad. Like, they numb you and the shots aren't that bad. They pinch a little bit. And then it's just this idea of having your jaw open for 2 hours and then like just drilling. Cause do you know the procedure for a root canal?
Yeah. I mean, you can explain it to the viewers for an exhilarating time, but I'm aware of what a root canal is. What's a root canal, Andrew?
You drill into the center of your tooth with a drill all the way almost to your jaw, and until you get to the nerve endings, and then you basically kill your nerve endings, right?
Yeah, I think.
And then they
I don't know the intricacies. Come on.
Then they shove poxy. I mean, I should know. I've had three. Then they shove poxy in, and then you come back, which is what I did. I came back. And then they drill around your poxy, and then they put a temporary cap. Then they take a 3D print of your mouth, and then they send it off, and then bam, you get some new teeth, and then they put those in.
Did your insurance cover that?
Dude, my insurance is baller.com. Yeah. Like, for instance, this each tooth costs about $3,000.
Yeah.
And my insurance, because I'm in the union, covers... It's one of the best part about being in the union is our insurance. My daughter cost me $20 to have. And then all three teeth cost $300.
That's dumb, because wanted to get, I'm trying to get, you know, the Invisalign or the Clear Smile, whatever, you know, because my teeth aren't super crooked by any means, but so I don't need braces. So Invisalign would fix it pretty easy. And the dentist is like, okay, well, to do that, we want to do a deep cleaning on your gums to make sure everything's perfect before we start moving them around. I was like, okay, no problem. She goes, you need this. I was like, okay, fine. Well, then we put in the claim to the insurance. They're like, well, this is an elective procedure because your teeth are fine, so you don't actually need this. It's like, but my dentist said I need it. They're like, no, you don't need it. We looked at the x-rays. You're fine. I was like, what? What does that even mean? She just told me I do need it. And now you're telling me I don't need it. I don't know. Everything's crooked.
That's American. That's the American.
Dude, I could do insurance. All this in cash in Korea or Japan. Like, I don't know Japan specifically, but I know in Korea. I paid everything cash because I didn't even have dental insurance, and it was cheap as hell. And the quality was, these people were all American educated dentists. So
they're probably better.
Yes. And they don't try to talk to you while your mouth pried open.
I know. Yeah. That's the one thing I do respect about my dentist. He's like from, I think he's like Pakistani or something. When I first went in, I was like, cause I was chewing at the time. I was like, can you check my mouth for cancer? And that's a crazy question to ask and terrifying too.
Yeah.
And he's like, what do you do? And I was like, I chew tobacco. He's like, oh, not good. That's not good. And I was like, yeah, I know. And then I opened my mouth and I was like, just let me know. And he's like digging through my gums. And then he doesn't say anything and he just gets to work. And I was just like, ah, like, it scared the crap out of me. But yeah, dude, no, our insurance is garbage. And I feel like big pharma in general, like they want they want people sick because they want a revolving door.
Yeah.
They want a revolving door constantly. That's why they feed us junk food. I would guarantee in Korea, you guys have, it's not necessarily junk food. It's, you guys, like, what kind of food is in Korea that's, is there McDonald's and all that?
Oh, yeah. There's everything over there that you could get here. There's limited variety. So as opposed to having, you'll have Reese's, you won't have 10 kinds of Reese's. Or you'll have Snickers, you'll have 10 kinds of Snickers. So I don't really think it's the availability of that stuff. They have that available. It's just, I don't know, the culture promotes healthy living a lot better. So I don't, these people that are like, we shouldn't have junk food in stores and we shouldn't have breakfast. I'm like, no, that's fun to eat sometimes and, you know, have a good time. People should have personal responsibility. But, it, you know, we just have not developed a culture of personal responsibility here. So, yeah, the pharma companies can do whatever they want. But at the end of the day, it's individuals making terrible choices to sit at home, not walk anywhere, not exercise, not eat good foods. And I will say, like, the Korean diet is much healthier. You have a lot of fermented foods, a lot of vegetables, a lot of not, I mean, you can get meat, but they eat a bunch of pork too. So that's supposedly not good for you, but Koreans eat pork all the time and they live to be 100 years old. So I think it's just more about the fact that everybody walks everywhere there. And I think the driving culture is the biggest problem here. I like to drive and I think people should be able to drive, but nobody walks anywhere.
Yeah.
So I have a
physical job. So whenever I see, like,
my wife used to watch
My 600-pound Life, and just to walk to go get the mail and come back was their exercise.
Yeah.
And that just blew my mind. I'm like, I do that at least 1,000 times or 5,000 times a day, that alone. And, like, I don't know. It's just, it's insane how far you can let yourself get whenever it comes to weight. I think I have body dysmorphia because right now I'm going to go to Vegas, June 1st, and I weigh 195 pounds and I want to get to 185. And I've been watching my diet. I eat four eggs in the morning. That's all I eat in the morning is four eggs. And then I'll eat whatever I want at night because I'm just counting calories.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I mean, yeah.
And it's working. I dropped to 191 real fast. But I'm also working out three times a week.
Nice.
And, but nothing like our boy, you know, who inspires me is our boy from Australia.
Matt Fox, dude.
Yes.
That guy's awesome. He's like the number, like, I don't know who's going to watch this, but he's the number one Instagram follow that I've ever followed.
Yeah.
He's so, yeah, same his here. Workouts are awesome and he's got such a good attitude and I don't know. The dude is cut as hell too. And he's a dad.
I sent him a message, when he was in Thailand, I asked him to come on the podcast.
Yeah.
And he wrote me back.
Nice.
And then I sent him, he basically said, you know, get back to me in 2 months when I'm back in Australia. And so I did. And then he kind of swerved me, I think, but maybe not. I'm trying to find
it. He's a busy dude.
What's his name again? Mike or Matt? Fox, there he is. But you're gonna laugh at the message I sent him. I said, he goes, hey mate, cheers for your message, for the message, well done with your fitness too. I was just telling him, he's like, I'm currently in Thailand for a few months with the family and time is limited due to smashing out work when I can and experiencing everything else, so not something I can do in the near future, but maybe in the next 2 months. And I basically said, that'd be great. So I hit him up again 2 months later. Dude, you are the man. You're a family man and also find time to clearly look like Batman. like the dude does.
Yeah.
He looks like Batman. Like, he's just jacked. But he's helped me a lot. You're the one who pointed me out to him. So I try his workouts. Half the time I can't finish him.
They're hard, man. I did one yesterday and it was good.
Oh yeah. I think you were doing one at Jeremy's house on the 4th of July. You had that.
Yeah. That's when I started doing them. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. No. And you don't need a gym. Like, that's the beautiful thing about him is, like, if there's ever another stupid pandemic and they freaking shut everything down again, I'm going to him and I'm just literally going to be outside doing his
workouts.
You just
need a couple dumbbells and a couple kettlebells and you can do everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
Great.
That's the beauty of it. We'll be done with the small chat. So I have you on because you are a geopolitical gangster and you know your stuff better than most people that I know. You work on a huge podcast and you're the main researcher for them, and it's pretty damn impressive what you know. And so that's why I wanted you on, man. I wanted to, and you're my homie, but I want to talk about the border crisis. I know that Biden sent, how much was it, 1,500 troops or 15,000?
1,500.
Okay. Who did he send? Like Marines or Army guys? Who knows, right?
Active duty. I assume it was just, I don't know. I don't know what branch they're from. I assume the Army or the National Guard. I don't know. But it was just 1,500 troops.
And what was the point of that exactly?
Basically to help with processing, to do paperwork and stuff like that. They're not repelling. They're not doing any sort of repelling of immigrants coming over.
Oh, okay.
The Texas,
so okay.
Now, Greg Abbott, the governor here in Texas, he sent down troops to repel them from just crossing over randomly. They're throwing up barbed wire. They're trying to stop it from just being a deluge. I don't know if that's the proper word, but just a flood across. So they're doing real work more than anybody from the federal government.
I was listening to your boy, Alex Jones, right before this podcast.
My boy. Alex. He is. I don't agree. Yeah. I don't know if me and him share the same outlook on life necessarily, but he's a super, super nice dude.
Is he?
Yeah.
Like when you met him, he was just very. He seems nice.
Incredibly
seems
genuine.
Cool.
So
really, really. So what you see is what you get.
Yeah, and
basically.
He really, like I said, we probably have different outlooks on strategies and the way the world works, but he does. I think he truly wants the best for everybody. He just has a kind of a eccentric way of, you know, displaying his thoughts, I suppose. But yeah, he's a good dude, really nice guy.
My thing with Alex is I really do like Alex too, and he is a hell of an entertaining character.
He's so yeah,
like I like if I'm really bored at work listening to comedy podcasts or, you know, really political people who just are fine line, like I'll be like, all right, it's time for Alex Jones. And I'll click on it. And instantly, dude, he's like, you'll be driving in your car. Yeah. And by the time you know, the blast will have hit you. And you won't even understand what happened. That is Russia and Ukraine. The nuclear war that will happen in America. Yeah. And you're just like, holy crap, homie. He's just real intense. But I think he's just got a lot of passion behind it because he wants to warn people of things that are happening.
Right.
But I think he does it in the most extreme way to get your attention.
Yeah.
And then it can be kind of overwhelming if
and
you
his explanation is usually the most conspiratorial, while mine is usually the dumbest answers the most likely. Like we have completely
Occam's razor.
Yes, we have completely opposite views. Like I think everything is much more surface level because I just don't think people are that smart. I think to be like a true conspiracy theorist, you have to have faith that there's really, really intelligent people out there. And I've just met too many people to believe that.
Yeah.
To believe that there's this massive group of really, really intelligent people that can pull off these kinds of conspiracies.
You know, my toes are in both waters. I kind of dip them, like I dip
my foot
deep.
It's fun. There's some conspiracies that I'm more prone to have belief in, for sure. But the one people are always like, well, see what happened with COVID. I was like, yeah, and everybody figured that out within like 2 months. So that's what, that disproves the whole government cabal thing because it was so easily disproven like that. And it only took
What do you mean?
Well, people are like, disproven. Well, the vaccine, you know, the vaccine conspiracy and the mask conspiracy. Fauci was lying about the masks. And we all figured that out within about a month, like the people on the right. And then within about 2 years, everybody in the world figured it out. So all these narratives that they were trying to push really hard basically fell apart within 2 years. So you're trying to tell me since 1969 that we have figured out how to hide the moon landing, and then we also had the best CGI of all time. Have you seen CGI from the 1960s? It's not good. Anyway,
you know
let's
what
not
got
get
me
to the moon landing. That's not why we're here.
You know what got me into believing that we didn't land on the moon? I'll just say this. I was chilling with some friends in Kansas, And they were like, hey man, we've never been to the moon. I'm like, okay. Just like, what do you mean? Like, it just was thrown at me. And they're like, check out this video. And it's the video of, you can look it up on YouTube. It's where the lunar module takes off from the moon.
Yeah.
And it looks, all I can say is it like shoots off this like glitter looking sparks. And then it goes up perfectly. The camera goes up with it. And then it's takes off. It looks exactly like Star Wars. And I was like, this is a Star Wars film, right? And they're like, no, this is, and I look and it says NASA, Apollo moon departure or whatever. And I, ever since then, I just have not believed we went to the moon.
Listen,
and
the last thing I'm going to say about this, I can't talk about this anymore. And I'll say it ad nauseum. The reason we were so gung-ho about getting to the moon is because we were in a space race with the Soviets and we wanted to prove that our systems were better than theirs. We went, and the Soviets have not disputed that. The Russians have never disputed that. It would have been in every bit of their interest to say, no, you didn't go, you faked it. They had spies everywhere in the United States. You don't think a Russian spy would have said, actually, they filmed that in a studio in Burbank. They probably had a spy working at NASA. They had, so to for no Russian source to ever come out and say, oh, actually, no, they faked that because we have intelligence to say so. Why would they not have done that? Because that was one of the biggest ticks against the Russian, because they went to space first, right? And they sent Sputnik into space and they sent a dog. So they wanted to go to the moon. Well, we beat them to the moon and they basically conceded that we beat them to the moon. Why would they do that if they clearly would have had intelligence to say otherwise? That's what I can't get over.
I understand that. And that's a great point because clearly you did have spies in the United States. And yeah, I could be wrong. We could have gone to the moon. It's just, I just have this, weird feeling of like, why say like, oh, we destroyed the technology. There's just the same amount of belief that you have in going, you can have the same belief in not going by looking at that information. So it's like, it's okay. I love diverse thoughts. I love people who believe in, you know, the fairy tale stuff. It's great. I'm just kidding.
The only thing I will say is a lot of the people that don't believe in the moon landing also don't believe that the Earth is round. There's a big overlap in that Venn diagram.
And I was going
to
say,
and I've flown on airplanes before and I can attest to the fact that the Earth is certainly round.
I was going to say, most people like in your, you know, your rebuttal of, you know, they had Russian spies and stuff like that. Well, Russia may be in on it to control the flat Earth theory. to keep people locked in. Okay.
Well, I don't know anything to say to that.
I used to make up conspiracy theories at work because I have a couple guys who are, if I'm being honest, they're off their rocker when it comes to this stuff. And so I had one called the Russian plug or something like that. And it was, and I was just making it up. And basically they had, Russia had drilled so far into the earth that they hit the core and they had to plug it. Because if they don't, it's going to blow up the planet. I was making, and then I had Devil's Tub, which is basically China did the same thing, but in the ocean, and they drilled really far down and they realized that it was going to suck all the water in and drain all the water in the world. So they called that the China Tub or something like that. I was anyways, but, I do have a question for you. Have you ever heard of, this is random, but have you ever heard of in Russia, they drilled, like they tried to drill as far as they could into the earth and they made it a long ways. And then they started hearing screams and voices out of that hole. And what they ended up doing was they freaked out. And so they put a cap over it and welded it and never like came back into it. It's not a conspiracy. Like it's just a, I need to look it up.
Yeah.
One of my friends at work was telling me about that. Another, yeah, the off the rocker one. But he asked me one time, he goes, have you ever heard of Russia digging into the earth and then they heard crazy screams come out of the hole? Anyways, this is just, that's just random.
I'll have to get into that. I'll have to check it out.
I'm going to look into it too. I never looked into it and I wish I would have now. But dude, this border crisis thing, what's the government is giving them phones. They're basically... aren't they just like letting him in and trucking him in and giving them phones and like telling them, hey, this and these are Democrat phones. So they're basically brainwashing them to vote. Is that like the big ploy of this border rush?
The idea of giving them the phones is that they can process them through some application that tells them about their court dates, because the way this, I guess I haven't really looked into what's on the phone. It's, I don't think it's like an iPhone or something like that, but I could be wrong. Either way, they shouldn't be getting phones because that's taxpayer dollars that are funding it. The problem is that they are coming in seeking asylum. So when you seek asylum, first of all, they're going through tons of countries to seek asylum in the United States, which doesn't make sense. Because you can fact check me on this, but I think that you need to seek asylum in the first country that you pass through. And they never do that. They come to the United States because obviously they want the benefits of our system, which is really funny because we're this white supremacist country. So it's really crazy how everybody that's not white wants to come to our country. But so the way this works is they come into the country, and if they process through a specific point of entry, they sit down with the government official, and the government official says, okay, you need to come back on this date and appear in court, and we'll hear your case for why you deserve asylum in the United States. Because whether they're fleeing cartels or political violence, you can't just be fleeing bad economic conditions. You actually have to prove that your life's at risk. Maybe your religion's getting persecuted. Maybe the cartel is taking over your town. Maybe the government is, I don't know, doing whatever, going on cleansing sprees of your ethnicity. And there are people throughout history that have obviously had that. The Vietnamese after the Vietnam War, you had, I don't know, people came from Sudan right now that I don't, whatever. There's legitimate cases for it. But what happens is you get a court date and the court hears and sees if your case is good. Well, a lot of the times they just say, okay, here's your court date. Go into the United States and come back on this date for court. We trust you. Half these people that are, I don't know half, but a lot of these people, we're seeing the papers that some of these journalists are showing, their court dates aren't until 2027, which basically means they're just let into the interior of the United States for five years and then trusted to come back for a court date. Yeah, right.
Yeah, I heard that today.
It's ridiculous. Like, this is so obviously planned. They wanted it to happen. There's no way they don't want it to happen because it's just ridiculous. No serious country would ever let this happen at their border. It's just an invasion of people. And I have extreme sympathy for people that really do want to come to the United States and seek a better life. I get it. The problem is we can't do this for everybody in the world. We don't have the capacity. No. It's really bad. It's terrible for culture because most of these people have no intention to, I don't want to use the word most because that's not a good phrase. A lot of these people have no intention to assimilate or become American. They want to come here, either make money, send it back home, do whatever. And a lot of these people, who knows what their intentions are, because they're just flooding across, right? Then they're coming through Mexico, which is basically governed by the drug cartel. And they're the ones smuggling these people over. They're smuggling people from all over the world. Who else is coming in? Well, why are there a bunch of military-aged single men coming through? Why aren't they staying in their countries to fix things? It doesn't make any sense, and it's so blatantly obvious what this administration is doing. And I haven't been this mad about something ever, because what they're trying to do is essentially just destroy the culture of what the United States is. They are. I mean, you cannot let in millions upon millions of people from around the world all at once and expect them to become American. That's not how it's going to work. It's just not how it's going to work. They don't, especially when they don't want to. They're coming here for economic benefits, not for free stuff. They're not coming here to start businesses. They're not coming here to, and again, not everybody. They're coming because we tell them you are going to get free stuff.
I work with a lot of guys who came across, I don't know, 20 years ago, but they became citizens, and they're upset.
Yes, of course.
They understand that they had to go through the green card process and a lot of hiccups and a lot of payments to become a citizen, and ultimately they're now hardworking Americans.
Right.
And
this isn't a race thing. This isn't a race thing at all.
It's a
fairness thing.
Yeah. And what was I gonna say? And one of them brought up a good point at lunch. He's like, they don't realize that making it in America is actually hard.
Yes.
It's not an easy task to be a taxpayer, to be literally an American citizen. It's not an easy task. It's not like you come here, like there's structure in place that makes you have to work right. for the most part. And he said if they think they're just going to come here and be like in the promised land, like it's a lot harder than it looks.
But that's the problem. Said. They come here and they don't have this dream just handed to them like they have been told. Then they become in despair. And then what do? Well, you have your gangs that are going to try to attract the younger people. You're going to have the people that are nefarious that are going to try to take advantage of that. It's just a socioeconomic disaster waiting to happen. And the fact that it's harder for a Japanese citizen with a PhD to become an American or to get to America than it is for somebody just walking up from Guatemala, that doesn't really make a lot of sense. Or Venezuela, that doesn't make a lot of sense. Immigration's great if those people are bringing something of value to your country. And I'm not saying that there's physical, but that's the other argument people are making, like who's going to pick the crops and who's going to work in the, well, that's a problem we're gonna have to figure out, but someone should do it. And that, if your excuse is we need to let illegals in because it's their job to pick crops, well, then that's kind of our problem as well that we've created.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a job for everybody in America. And I do believe here's my theory is like there probably is like 30% good people, 50% lazy. I don't know. Like probably just not. Anyways, but like there's also child traffickers
oh and all my that God, kind of yes. stuff
that is coming through and that's gonna be I heard a story and I heard on Rogan that a girl got raped, like they found a 9-year-old girl and she'd been like they found over 60 men's semen and she'd been raped and that kind of stuff is going on. The human beings are terrible, actually.
Well, that's
these perfect things.
No, and that's the other thing that no one's considering is if you really care about these people, why are you encouraging them to come on these trips that are being facilitated by mules,
cartel.
Right? By human smugglers that are going to take advantage of the children, that are going to take advantage of the women, that and then are going to, you know, do whatever they can to benefit themselves. They don't care about these people in a humanitarian sense. And Ted Cruz went on this really, I kind of actually loved what he said. They're talking about sympathy, but somebody asked the Mayorkas, I always forget his title, the Homeland Security person, maybe I forgot what his title is, I can look it up, but somebody asked him how many people died in transit to the United States, and he said he didn't know. And Ted Cruz dropped the numbers, like 900 or something like that have been found dead just trying to make the crossing. They don't care about those Damn. people. They don't care at all. This is not a humanitarian thing. They see these people as pawns and they're taking the people that sincerely want to come here. I feel for them, but our country doesn't have the capacity to take care of the entire world.
No.
So there has to be some sort of system in place where a limited number can be let in.
What does this mean for our country then? What does it mean for our country?
Well, it's just a consistent degradation of our culture, of a shared sense of culture. Because if you're coming here for economic benefits and just to escape something else, you're not coming here for opportunity or to become American. Then it's just America already is so fragile in its existence because we don't have a shared ethnicity. We don't have a shared religion necessarily. What we do have is a shared sense of idea and belief in the Constitution and our founding documents. And most people coming here, not most, because you will look at the people that have earned their citizenship, they know more about American civics and American culture than most people born here.
Yeah. So my mother-in-law had to take a test.
Yeah.
She became a citizen in 2017. And
that's great.
She had to take a test and like, she was asking me some of the questions and I didn't know them. I was like, you had to know all that? And she's like, yeah.
Yeah.
And so they do have to go through this like tough question.
But when there's a low ball estimate, 11 million people here illegally, that's costing, how much is that costing the United States, not only in terms of dollars, but in terms of these new enclaves setting up, these new cultures? Like they're just taking their culture and putting it into, it's not like before where the Italians would come or then the I don't know, the Vietnamese would come, whoever would come, and they'd bring parts of their culture, but they would, it was called a melting pot, right? Because it would melt into the American culture. Well, now that's racist, right? To have a melting pot, you need to have a, what do they call it? A salad. What kind of salad do you, a tossed salad, not a tossed salad. But
ain't nothing wrong with those
either. Basically,
the
things don't melt together. You just throw it in the pot and shake it up, and they're all existing together within the same bowl, but they're not becoming the same thing. That's a problem.
Okay.
So the United States can't exist upon that, because without this shared idea and us coming together around that idea, it's trouble. That's, I think that's the most concerning thing for the future of the United States, is the loss of our greater culture.
So do you think...
Not a racial thing. I want to make that clear. This is not a racial thing at all. Because from the beginning...
It's a culture thing.
From the very beginning, America was never a racial society. It's not Korea. It's not Japan. It's not the Middle East where it's Islam, right? It's an idea of our founding documents.
Freedom.
And freedom, right? And our sense of, you know, God-given rights, whether that's not, it doesn't matter, have to be necessarily from our Christian God, but from the universe, if you will. It's not government bestowing those rights upon you. So if we don't have that shared sense of what it means, what America means at its core, then we're screwed, because we don't have that ethnic bond. We don't have that religious bond. We don't have anything other than a shared idea. And I don't think the Democratic Party really has any intention of conserving that idea of what America is. I think they hate it. I think they actively hate it.
Yeah, I think they do too. You know, to switch topics, Russia and Ukraine, for the most part, has been pretty quiet on social media on my end. Mm-hmm. And normally when it's loud, that means something's going on. Because I don't look too much into it. I kind of ask you questions on it to make sure I'm up to date with what's going on. So with Russia and Ukraine, what is today? Today is Saturday, May 13th, 2023. What exactly do you know where we're at with this whole Russia-Ukraine war? Like, what have you seen go on?
I mean, it doesn't look like Russia's doing phenomenal. I haven't been following this extremely closely, but I do know that Ukraine has been prepping for what they call their counteroffensive, which means to retake retake territory that's been taken from them. There's been talk that this includes Crimea, parts of the eastern provinces. I don't know, but the biggest news right now has been coming around that city in Bakhmut, right? It's in eastern Ukraine, and I think it's in Donetsk, which is one of the provinces that Russia has been in control of basically over the last decade. There's a lot of ethnic Russians there, but it doesn't seem to be going fantastic for the Russians, because there was the video that was just released by the Wagner group. I'm sure you've heard of them. It's like that paramilitary. So they don't actually work. I mean, they are essentially contracted by the state, and they're outfitted by the state, and they're paid by the state, but they're not part of the actual government, right?
Isn't Russia not giving them enough guns?
So that's what ammo? That's what he's saying, that they're, I don't know how you say it, Prigozhin or whatever, the guy that founded them, their leader, he's throwing shade at the defense ministry and you know, Putin, not directly, but essentially at Putin for not giving them enough ammunition, not giving them enough guns, not giving them the logistical support that they need. And he's threatened to, if they don't get it, basically to either bail out, start revealing details of Russia's military casualties. Like he threatened to go basically scorched earth on him if he doesn't get resupplied. So it doesn't really seem like things are going as fantastic. Obviously, Russia always expected this to be an in and out kind of thing. We're going to take it over. Didn't work. So now it's become a war of attrition. So Ukraine will mount up their counter offensive, try to retake parts, territory that they've lost or has been in Russian hands for a while. See what happens. I don't really know their chances of success, to be honest with you. I don't know the military strategy that they plan to employ, but that's kind of where we are now. And it seems like it's sort of at a, not a stalemate, because the Russians are taking more
strategy being
their strategy. And the Russians are obviously taking way, way, way more heavy casualties than the Ukrainians are, mostly because their equipment sucks ass. And they're
sending a lot of prison guys too. I've seen what they do is they'll there'll be like bunkers with like, or whatever, an area with Ukrainian soldiers, and they'll send in three prison Russian. So these guys that were in prison in Russia, they'll send them in, and basically those dudes are chopped liver, and they find out where the Ukrainians are hiding because they get shot at almost all. Like, I've seen videos, dude, of these like three dudes just getting mowed. But then they find out where the Ukrainians are. Then they send in their actual military, and it's kind of a strategy. You taught me that Russia likes to throw a lot of bodies at the problem.
Yeah.
And then like, that's like been their biggest strategy of war for a long time.
Yeah. I mean, they definitely don't, especially right now, they don't have the technology that the Ukrainians have, because the Ukrainians are supplied by the West, and the Western military tech is way better than anything Russia has in terms of like traditional warfare. When it comes to nuclear options, you know, it's a different conversation, but they're still dealing with Soviet era, the Korean War era tanks, right? So they're getting just fucked up, for a lack of a better term. So I don't know, that it is what it is. The Russians are taking heavy casualties. The Ukrainians are fighting valiantly. I don't know where this ends, but that's as far as I can tell where we are right now.
It's so dumb. It's so dumb. Like, I get the whole defending. I've been on this topic for a minute, but I get the whole defending your country. I get it.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's probably pretty patriotic to stay and fight. And it probably is nice to have the number one country send you all the money in the world and get you all suited up to protect it. And there's part of me that thinks, oh, that's, you know, that's kind of nice of us to do. But then there's also a part of me that's like, okay, don't you want to sow for peace? Don't you want to, you know, de-escalate and figure this out? It's been going on for how long? A year and a half?
Yeah, it would be a year and 3 months at this point.
Yeah. And so it's like, I've heard that, was it Russia that wanted to have Russia wanted to talk, and then Biden's the one saying, no, there's no talking or whatever. I don't know.
No, I don't know. I can't speak to that.
Okay. Nobody's tried to sow for peace right now? Nobody has tried?
No, I mean, the Chinese came in and said they were going to try to facilitate some sort of dialogue between the two countries, but that dialogue sounded a lot like, we're just going to make the peace settlement really advantageous for us, and it was stupid. And if you actually read through it, it didn't make any sense. But I mean, it made sense for China, and it was good for Russia on paper. And of course, Ukraine's like, we welcome the efforts to increase dialogue, but it wasn't a serious attempt at anything. I don't think any side's really made a serious attempt at that. And it's as long as Ukraine, like I said, is resisting the way that they are and continuing to get Western support, and the Russians are not really accomplishing what they wanted to accomplish, there's not a lot of incentive right now for Ukraine to take a deal that favors Russia in any sense of the word, because Russia's not in a great position to negotiate. But I don't know if Ukraine's in a great position to negotiate, so maybe that means they're both in a good position to negotiate. I don't know, but I don't see how this ends without some sort of a peace settlement.
Well, I have a video from Trump on CNN, and I'm going to play it, and I want to know what your thoughts are after I play it.
You say if you want Ukraine or Russia to win this war.
I want everybody to stop dying. They're dying. Russians and Ukrainians. I want them to stop dying. And I'll have that done. I'll have that done in 24 hours. I'll have it done. You need the power of the presidency to do it.
But you won't say that you want Ukraine to win.
You know what I'll say? I'll say this. I want Europe to put up more money, because they're in for 20 billion. We're in for 170, and they should be, and they should equalize.
What are your thoughts on what he's saying? Do you really think if he, you know, because 2024 is going to come up quick. It's going to come around the corner.
Yeah.
We're going to have a new election and a new president, hopefully. I don't believe in Biden at all. I'll take Trump every day. I'll take Trump every day over Biden. But do you think Trump could actually de-escalate it?
Potentially. It's not going to be a day. It wouldn't be a day. And I don't think I think a huge part of the reason nothing happened under his watch is because he was so crazy. Nobody knew what he was going to do. And I don't think he knew what he was going to do. So that was kind of the unpredictable element that no one wanted to upset that balance of stability that was there. And they didn't want a huge asymmetric response from him, which he very well could have done. Who knows? But the problem is it's already started. And I still don't think Trump has a plan. I don't think Trump ever had a plan. His unpredictability was his strongest card. But now that it's already happened, what is his actual plan to finish? I don't think he has one. Because he never has said what it would be. He's never hinted at it. I think he's just talking. Now, so when he said he won't say he wants Ukraine to win, I think that's probably smart. I don't know what he actually believes, but if you want to have negotiations and you see yourself as the president in 2 years, you can't say that, because then going into the negotiation, you've already kind of handicapped yourself. I would hope that I think in a perfect world, any American should want Ukraine to win, but in a realistic world, we have to understand that victory doesn't mean total defeat of Russia. Victory could just mean settling for what it was before the war started. Victory is a very loose sense of, it's a very fluid term right now. But
that is true.
What he says about Europe is absolutely true. That's absolutely true. The fact that we have put up way more money than all of the European Union combined is ridiculous. It's insane that we have done as much as we have while letting the Europeans ride our coattails, because it's fucking us big time.
Yeah. And it's in Europe. So yeah. Europe, you might want to throw out some cash, because that's dealing with you way more than it's dealing with us.
Right.
That's my opinion
on it. If Ukraine completely fell, it wouldn't be great for our, geopolitical strategy overall, but it would have limited effects on us. It would fuck Europe.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's already, the energy crisis in Germany and everywhere else, it's the reason the UK is $12 a gallon for gas. Like the whole inflation is because of this war in a lot of ways. Especially in Europe.
Yeah.
Especially in Europe. All right. Thanks for the update. It's always interesting talking to you about Ukraine, Russia, because I don't know what the hell's going on. And not a lot of people do. And for the most part, as days go by, as weeks go by, as the sun rises and the sun sets, I tend to forget about it. And I care for the sense of humanity, but I also don't care. It's weird. And I'm trying to understand what side to be on, if I'm being honest. And it's hard.
I would caution equating both sides in this, because they're not equal. One is clearly the aggressor. One seems to have much larger ambitions, and Ukraine wants territorial integrity and sovereignty. So I really hate on the right when they try to equate these as the same country fighting each other. It's not. Russia and Ukraine are not the same country. Russia, in my opinion, is very clearly the aggressor. They are the bad guy in the situation. Does that mean Ukraine is a bunch of perfect little angels and Zelensky is the best thing since sliced bread? No, they have problems. And if Ukraine would have went in and tried to, bomb Moscow to start this, I would have said, okay, you're probably in the wrong here, but they didn't. The West made a lot of mistakes that they could have avoided this, but at the end of the day, we can understand why Putin might have done what he did, but I can understand why somebody that was raised without a father might have tendencies to commit crimes. I get it. But that doesn't mean the crimes that they committed
are validated.
Yeah. So there's a difference between understanding motivations and understanding the psyche of your opponent and validating them as equal to the opposite side. I just don't think that's true. I think that's a very simplistic take of people that don't really want to think about it too hard. And I'm not saying that's you. I'm thinking that's a lot of people on the right. And I think a lot of people on the right think that Putin is some sort of savior of Western Christendom and conservatism. He is just not those things.
Well, he just looks better with the whole trans movement in the West. Like, cool. His values will look better because it's like, well, he wants to value the religion or whatever, the Catholic
orthodoxy,
orthodoxy in the mother, father at home, whatever, but it's still communism. But yeah, I could see why his take is nicer than Biden's take, or
Biden's take's stupid.
It's just, you look at Biden and all his takes and that whole administration, it's just full of nonsense. It's full of fantasy land nonsense, and people like it just softens Americans. It's softening the American culture, like you were talking about. Like, not only is this border crisis an issue for our culture, but this administration is an issue for our overall culture as well. Speaking of, you know, trans culture, you and I were talking about China and Taiwan, and that's what we're going to switch this topic to.
Let's take a break real quick. No, I'm just going to use the restroom real quick, and then we can.
All right, do your thing.
Don't use antibacterial soap, also, for your information.
Why?
Because if you don't need it, you can just use regular soap. And the more antibacterial soap we use, it drains into the sewer system and basically creates antibiotic-resistant bacteria, which is really dangerous, actually.
I'm probably going to leave that in. That's probably where we'll come into it.
Yeah, okay.
Because that's interesting, so don't use antibacterial soap.
No, there's no need to.
It drains into the sewer system and kind of creates these super bacterias or what?
Yeah, I mean, it's not like it drains in and all of a sudden there's a mega bacteria that's going to take over the world. But
yeah, it's just repeatedly
exposing something to something that it wants to defend against makes it stronger. Just like when you take antibiotics for viral infections. Well, that's dumb. Because now all you're doing is getting your body used to, or
antibiotics,
getting used to antibiotics,
getting the virus.
And then also people not finishing. Well, you have a virus, an antibiotic is for a bacteria, but doctors will just say, let's just take an antibiotic. Okay, but I have a virus. So the antibiotic is doing nothing to stop the virus. And it's just causing a greater resistance to the possible bacteria that could be out there that do want to kill me. So yeah, if you ever get an antibiotic regimen, finish it. Always finish it. Never take like two and think I'm better and then don't finish it. Finish your entire thing. That's my PSA for the day.
Okay. Or else we're going to end up like The Last of Us or what?
Well, that's a fungus, but we would be, it'll just be so something like MRSA, right? Staph infection. Like that. There's already strains of it
out there. Super staphs?
Yeah, super staph essentially that antibiotics can't fix. And I think another one, penicillin. No, not penicillin. What is it? It's a gonorrhea. Yeah, I think there's an it's gonorrhea bacteria. I think it is. But it's becoming
it's bacterial.
It's becoming resistant to penicillin, I believe.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure thousands and millions of people take some form of antibiotic for that because they freak out. You know, you have sex and then all of a sudden that's part of your daily BS and you're going to want to get rid of it.
Gonorrhea has developed resistance to nearly all the antibiotics used for its treatment. We are currently down to one last recommended effective class of antibiotics.
Treat this. So to all you single people out there having a good time, watch yourself. That sounds like not fun at all.
Wrap it up, boys.
Wrap it up, boys. Put a helmet on. So this China-Taiwan situation, do you see it inevitable? Do you see it happening in the near future, the takeover of Taiwan by China?
Do I see it actually? Do I see them trying it, inevitably trying it?
Yes.
Or yes.
Well, this war, this wouldn't it technically be World War III if it went down?
So we'll have to talk about what the war looks like because you had that question before. So,
yes. What does that look like?
So I will say, to back up just a little bit to the Ukraine-Russia thing, the reason why our unending support for Ukraine is so dangerous is because the Russia front does not mean that much to us, strategically speaking. Northeast Asia, where Taiwan is, where China is, where Korea and Japan are, that is the most important region of the world because it's going to be over 50% of all the world's economy, if it's not already. It's very close to it. Now, the more resources we spend, the more ammunition, the more whatever we throw at this problem in Eastern Europe means we don't have that same payload. We don't have that same ammunition. We don't have the same missiles to use in the event of a Taiwan crisis, right? We also don't have the political capital. Now, I think it was CSIS, which is the Center for Strategic and International Studies, ran a war games sort of scenario, you know, where they put in their computer programs and say, here's what a war would look like. I believe they said within the first 2 weeks, the United States would run out of a lot of key ammunition. Mostly because, well, for two reasons, our industrial base that needs to produce all this stuff is just not where it needs to be. And we've already given away tons of it to Ukraine. And the Taiwanese are not spending enough money on their own defense. So there's a lot of problems that we need to deal with. Now, back to your question, do I think it's inevitable? Yes, unless something crazy happens to Xi Jinping. I think as long as Xi Jinping is in power, I think it's going to happen. I think there's no question about it. I think if he realizes he's on his way out, he'll do it. And he has absolute authority over that entire country. So, yes, I think it is going to happen. And I would say, I don't know, by 2030, they want to be prepared to do it by 2027. They want to be ready to do it. They've said that. That doesn't mean they've set the date to do it then. That means they want to have everything in place where they could do it by 2027. That's not very far at all. So do I see it happening? Yeah, I definitely see it happening.
Okay. What do you mean by Xi Jinping might, before he's on his way out?
Well, he's old.
He's not that old, is he?
Pretty old.
How old is Xi Jinping?
He's in his 70s.
Look this up. Hey Siri, how old is Xi Jinping?
What'd you get? I'd say mid 70s.
Siri's retarded. And this is why I don't believe
him. He's 69.
Okay.
Well, and he's Chinese. They live to be about 110, so maybe he's got some time left.
That's what I'm saying, but, dude. Still, he's a big dude. He's actually pretty big, isn't he?
Yeah, I don't think he's a small guy. But if he sees any threat to the future of the country, I mean, there's a lot of problems in China. There's tons and tons and tons of problems that they're facing domestically. And I think all of that just incentivizes him to do it more. So if he starts seeing his health is failing, or that the economy, he can't keep up the economy and he needs to gin up domestic support, whatever it may be, as long as he is in charge, it is going to happen before he is not in charge anymore.
That's what trips me out about, you know, being in a recession, because we are, you know, or in hyperinflation of everything. And with this administration, if Biden gets elected again in 2024, I see a war being like a way of getting out of the recession or whatever. Like, you know what I mean? Like boosting the economy to produce for a war. I don't know. I'm not sure exactly how all that works. It just seems like
the thing is, we could already be doing that now as a form of deterrence. We could already be ramping up spending on, or not spending, but manufacturing for key ammunitions, for ships, for planes. We could already be doing that, but we're not. So I don't
interesting.
Know. Yeah. I don't know if that would be the case in the future, potentially, but.
You saw that video of that trans person in the Navy, right? That's what cracks me up. I'm like, you guys, like, they want all these people to join the military, and I'm like, you guys realize you'll probably be in the Taiwan Pacific here in about 4 years or whatever, 5 years, fighting in the Taiwan Pacific in your dresses and your eyeliner. That's what trips me out about this whole movement. I'm like, you know what I mean though?
Yeah, I just don't. We are just not
it's so crazy.
We are just not a serious country in so many ways. Like you said, I don't know if this will be World War III. Hope, like, whatever the circumstance, hopefully we could avoid that. But the fact that we're not preparing for that is a real possibility, and instead spending resources on diversity and inclusion and making sure that there's representation in the military, that's so stupid. That's not the military's job. It's a machine that should be geared toward, and again, I don't want to speak too authoritatively on the military because I wasn't in the military, but I do understand that its function to be effective should be to win. And making sure that drag queens feel comfortable in the military is not that. Again, what you want to do in your own personal lives, I really don't care as long as you're of age for the most part. But to try to make it seem like we need to make that a core part of our military institution is ridiculous. And we're getting laughed at, and we're not preparing. We're not doing the things that we need to do to avoid this situation. So we're bringing it on ourselves, and it very might be too late by the time we decide that we need to turn course. I hope it's not, but so I really
what
hope.
A, you know, I hear that from a lot of Americans, like, you know, if, yeah, it's like, because we're all left with this confused idea of like, dude, why is this going on? And then wait, and then we also see big problems out there that we haven't seen in my lifetime.
Yeah.
Like, and so it's like we have these massive problems, and then we have these very minuscule problems that we blow up here in the United States.
Right.
At least this administration does. And it leaves Americans, especially, you know, free thinking, smart people, start thinking, why is this happening? Like, why? It leaves you with almost like despair. Like, oh, like, what are we doing? You know what I mean?
Right.
That whole thought. And so, you know, you say it might be too late. And a lot of people say that it might be too late. What does that mean to you?
So
it might be too late.
Specifically, I mean, we could talk about domestically, we could, you know, crush ourselves from the inside, which is very possible. But I don't really have time to get into all of those, nor do I have the expertise to do so. But what I mean that it might be too late as far as our foreign policy is concerned, where we should be trying to bulk up our military to be preparing for the greatest potential peer rival that the United States has ever seen. Probably, I would say most definitely that this is the greatest peer rival the United States has ever seen in terms of capability and desire and economic might. But the thing is, what I mean by too late is if our Navy and our military is not prepared and our policymakers are not ready to either deter an invasion or to repel an invasion once it takes place, and China does take over Taiwan, then life in the United States will drastically change as we know it. And the problems that we have found the time to come up with, like fake racism and fake homophobia and making sure we can talk about who teachers have sex with to their students, those problems will go away real quick because we'll have a lot more important things to worry about, like food, like jobs, like control. We'll have real problems if China wins that war. Americans can't fathom the idea that something that happens somewhere else could affect us here. That's why people get so bored with it. But if China takes over Taiwan, what life has been for America since 1900 will be incredibly different. We will no longer have the privileges and the lifestyle that we have become accustomed to. It'll be a lot more despair, a lot more economic hurt, and it just won't be good. And we'll have real problems. Because if they take over Taiwan, then essentially what that means is we failed to deter it. So we probably lose confidence with everybody else in Asia. So they start turning to China. They start trying to cut deals. And now China is essentially in charge of 50% of the world's economy. And they're the largest trading partner for a lot of countries in Europe, a lot of countries in South America. So now with China having this amassed power, they have even more influence. Think about the influence we have over Russia and how we can manipulate their financial systems, right? Well, now imagine that on steroids if China takes over Northeast Asia. Because first, like the micro, like starting at the middle and then going out, Taiwan Semiconductor Company is the most advanced chip maker in the entire world. Let's assume that China becomes in charge of that. Well, okay, now they control all the components to the world's major technology. They control the world's busiest trade routes. They can basically have influence over half the world's economy. And the countries that don't agree to fall in line with them are going to be punished economically, tariffs, trade deals, rights to goods, things like that. And then the countries that resist will be punished. The countries that resist will be punished. Well, a lot of people are like, well, America is separated by, you know, oceans. Yeah, we'd probably be physically secure. I don't think China's going to come in at least right away and try to do anything. But who are we going to trade with? Who are we going to get good trade deals with? Who are we going to sell our goods to? Nobody. We'd only be about 20% of the world's economy at that point, and the other 80 would essentially be controlled by the Chinese, or not necessarily controlled, but they'd have heavy influence over those decisions. And eventually, what China would want to do, because historically this is what happens, they would want to further reduce our power because we would be the only country that could theoretically turn the tides and change that and take away their influence. So what would they do? While they have the power, they would consistently chip away at ours. whether that's, you know, taking Guam and then taking Hawaii, or I don't know what it means, but they would definitely want to erode our
process.
Yes. And so that's, it's a catastrophic situation where America becomes unrecognizable if China takes over Taiwan and continues to expand their influence outward.
And this is kind of for our kids.
Yeah.
Like this is like basically maybe even a computer will be hard to come by.
Yes.
Or a TV.
Yeah. Sure.
Like the things that we have at Best Buy that are $1,000 for a 72-inch TV will now be
even more important by that.
Or whatever.
Even more important than the actual, I think it's, it would be more expensive, but the information that we're allowed to receive through those things would be wholly filtered through what the Chinese Communist Party thought was appropriate, because we know the problems with TikTok, right?
Interesting.
We know the app that they control and how that algorithm is designed to manipulate the American populace, especially young people. We know that. That's proven. Okay, now imagine China in charge of all the supply chains to all these major tech companies that make these apps. Essentially, everyone at that point is working for a Chinese company. Every American is working for a Chinese company downstream. And more than that, China has the final say of the information that you can receive through those devices. So you think it's bad now. Well, we have Twitter, you know, you have Elon, you have that whole discussion that we can have. But they become in charge of the entire flow of information through the tech companies that they're in charge of, because they control the supply chains and the markets of those companies.
I often wonder, after reading 1984, like how can it fully be like that book? Like we see some forms of that, you know, now in censorship and thought speech and all that. And you know, war is peace. And just, you start to see a lot of correlations in that book. But to me, I'm like, it'll never be fully what that book was. But under a China authoritarian, it could be.
Yeah,
very well close. It
very well could be.
Very well close.
Especially when you have large parties in the West that are sympathetic to the idea of state control, right?
Yeah.
So, I don't know. That's
so, all right, I am political. I still am. I'm definitely conspiratorial. And I do think that there's agendas and all that, like the 2030 agenda.
Before we get to that, can I just...
No. I won't dive into it, but I was just going to explain. But I also come down from the clouds every now and then and sit down and talk about, okay, what's really in control? Politics. And the people that are running these things are actually in putting into play, like, actual law or whatever, decisions. Like... That's why I like to talk to you, because these are actual decisions being made.
Yeah.
And like, this is what could actually happen. So you're more on the lines of like, what could possibly happen? And so that's why that's terrifying. And it's like, what is the system? Because part of me wants to pull out and be like, you know what? Two wings of the same bird, fuck it, you know, and like, just totally, maybe I should just chill with my family and maybe move back to my small town and try to control the politics in that small area to, you know what I mean?
Right.
I don't know what to do. And so talking to you, you know, we have these two options in 2024, Trump or Biden, and it's back down to those guys. And I'm going to pick Trump. I'm going to vote for Trump all day. I see what Biden's done, and anybody who has seen it can clearly know that Trump is the better candidate for our country, at least. And so my thing is, in this upcoming election, is there a hope for when Trump gets in to like turn the tides?
Well, so, I want to think how I want to do this, because do you want to go back to the China thing? Because I think there's another part of the conversation that we need to have, because.
Yeah.
Or do you want us to do this then go back? Because I do want to address something.
No, this one's an easy one. It's like basically Trump and Biden 2024. What's your thoughts in the future?
Well, I have.
We'll go back to that question. So go on off on this China thing.
Well, the only thing, like what I said, what I explained to you is this scenario that myself, and I'm not the greatest political scholar by any means, but other people much smarter than me envision if they win. Them trying does not mean that they win, right? If we are prepared, which we still have time to do, if we do get someone better in 2024, which hopefully we can talk about in a second.
Yeah.
China actually invading and taking over Taiwan is a very, very, very difficult thing. And I know you wanted to talk about what the war looks like.
Yeah.
It is very, very bloody and very, very difficult for China to execute. So the fact that they are going to try, I vehemently believe that they're going to try. Even if we are not mildly, because we need to take it extremely seriously. If we are prepared, it's a very, very tall task for them. Because the only way that they would eventually be able to do it would be a amphibious invasion of Taiwan. They're not going to be able to do it with an economic blockade or bombing the cities from the mainland. They're going to have to physically take over the island. And actually, invading Taiwan is extremely difficult for many reasons. One, because it's a very well-fortified island. They've spent years doing it. But also the fact that the terrain, the coasts are very hard. It's not Normandy, right? You think of a beach invasion. You think of Normandy, right? You think of long coastal stretches of nice sand for the boats to pull up on. Now, I'm not saying that Normandy was easy, but the geography was very advantageous to an amphibious landing. Taiwan's coasts are not that. The coast closest to China is very urbanized, and there's lots of rice paddies. There's lots of marshland. There's lots of concrete structure. There's water that comes down from the mountains that basically turns the beaches. And they're like rocky. They're not sandy kind of picturesque beaches. So that's already very difficult. The backside of the country is mountains and cliffs. So that's hard. There's only about four. I think there's a really good book about this. There's only 14 locations that are actually suitable. And out of those, only two are considered high success rates. And more than that, there's only about 2 months out of the year that this kind of invasion could take place because the waters are so dangerous. So then the you have to get Taiwan to surrender once the Chinese go in. And what our whole strategy is predicated on, the United States, if we were to come to their aid, and I firmly believe we would, and I firmly believe the Japanese would too, because the Japanese, it's just as much in their interest to prevent China from
protect this
becoming
island.
A hegemon in Northeast Asia. Yeah, for sure. And probably Korea at that point, Australia. I think we would have a nice coalition of Asian states that would help. But what our goal is to prevent something called a fait accompli, which is a French word. It basically just means, okay, it's happened. We can't do anything about it. So what China would do, what we want to stop them from doing is taking land and us saying, okay, well, I guess you have that. Okay, you took this land. We want to stop them from doing something before we can do anything about it. So that's why we are, if they get in there, land quick, take Taipei, kill the president, it's kind of like, well, what do we do at this point, right? So we want to stop that from happening. That's a very difficult thing for them to do because of the logistics of it. They could take parts of the beach. They could land and take parts of the inland, and then the government could be moved, whatever. But let me rewind on this a little bit. Just because they take part of Taiwan does not mean they have taken Taiwan. Because there's different options after they do that. You can do something called vertical escalation, which means we increase the intensity of the war in the Taiwan Strait and on Taiwan. Or horizontal escalation, which means we maybe start bombing places in mainland China. Or we do, I don't know, economic warfare and cut off their shipping routes from oil from the Middle East or from Russia, whatever. So there's two choices. What we have to avoid, and this is what you talked about earlier, is we don't want it to become World War III at all costs. So anything that we have to prevent them from getting to a position where our next move would cause escalation, because the more escalation that we cause, the more they don't have it in their interest to make this a global war either. Because eventually that becomes so destructive for both sides that it's kind of a no-win for either side. So what we have to prevent them from doing is getting to a position of strength where it would require us to escalate. Because if we escalate, they have options to escalate. And then you end up escalating into total war. We want to keep it a limited war if this happens. So what we need to do is get Taiwan to spend more money on their defense. We need to spend more on ammunitions. We need to improve our diplomatic channels with Beijing. We need to make sure that the Japanese are spending more money on their defense. There's a lot we need to do to prevent China from getting to such a place of strength to achieve this state of conflict where we're like, oh shit, they're already here. They've already achieved this. Now we either let them have it or we escalate, because you don't want to get to a place. That's when you get to a World War III. It's when they've achieved these small gains that we've done nothing about, and our only option is to make it bigger. That's the big, that's when the big problems come in. That's when you see a World War III. Because probably speaking, a Chinese war with Taiwan, or China invading Taiwan, doesn't require, our participation doesn't require a ton of boots on the ground in Taiwan. It's high-tech support from our Air Force and our Navy, and maybe potentially some counterinsurgency from Marines and the Army. I don't know enough about military logistics, but I know that we aren't going to send hundreds and hundreds of thousands of troops dropping into Taiwan. That's not what our participation probably looks like.
What if North Korea, like, you know, you say an invasion does happen in Taiwan. What if North Korea gets a wild hair up his ass to try to take South Korea again?
Great possibility, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's my thoughts.
Yeah.
On that,
I mean,
too.
You could have a domino sort of situation, and then there is crazy escalation.
World War.
And then China. Yeah. And then China at that part decides, okay, we also want to take all these islands that we're arguing with Japan over. And yeah, so there could be. But the thing is, this also, we also have the potential. And this is a country that we never talk about that needs to be talked about, is India. Because the Chinese and the Indians have their own major problems along their border with territory. So what,
really,
as much as we need to be supporting Taiwan, we need to be supporting India at the same time, in my opinion. We have disagreements with them, but they're super, super important. Because if we're convincing China, if China's trying to get us in a two-front war, right, maybe whether it's in Russia or in, you know, Eastern Europe and Northeast Asia, or they try to start something in Korea where we're fighting there too, well, we want the Indians to be in a good position to deter them on their Western side, because the Indians have every shared interest with us in deterring China, because they're China's biggest rival in that region, right? And India just recently passed them in terms of population. They are competing interests. They have very different ideas about what they want that region to look like. So if China takes over Taiwan, that's not good for India. So India has a lot of, if not participating in the conflict, which I don't think that they probably would, they might, but they have a lot of self-interest in making sure China doesn't become too strong. So us providing them support and forcing China to care about two fronts is another strategy that we definitely need to consider.
India is the beautiful thing about
India is very, very important.
Okay. I've never even thought of that, but yeah, that makes sense. That's the beautiful thing about America, is how we have no neighbors left.
Yes.
No neighbors right. Like, it's great. In Mexico, what's up, my Mexican friends? They're the best. Like, well, I know that there's a lot of crazy shit that goes on in Mexico, but it's still, I love Mexico.
Yeah,
and
me
then
too.
You got retard up north.
God.
And he could just stay Riri.
Yeah.
Dude, like, not to bump too far away from this topic, but yeah, man, like, you got assisted suicide, like, in Canada. Like, they're just off. They're the mental disability that is up north that has tracked its way into our administration too, is, I just want it gone.
Yeah. Right?
And that's why it comes up on our next topic, Biden and Trump, and like what that looks like in 2024. And then Trump has to get elected at the end of the day. Like, and I know you're not the biggest fan of Trump. You've let me know, hey, he's got a losing record. And that's what scares me a lot. I don't care for, what is it? The Kennedy guy?
Yeah.
I don't really, do you care for him?
I mean, what he has the potential to do is steal some votes from Joe Biden, which would be nice.
Like, come on. Yeah. I'll take that.
He's got some good points. He's a little crazy and he's basically an eco-terrorist, but
yeah, I was going to say he wants to throw us in jail if we don't believe in climate change and stuff. I'm like, dude, all right, you're off your rocker too.
And he sounds really weird.
He had cancer. I don't know. He had a problem, so I don't know what it was, but
yeah, I mean, that's unfortunate, but yeah, we'll wrap it up with this Trump and Biden conversation in 2024. I'm all for Trump. I really am. I don't care who cares. I'd take him every day over Biden if we're going to talk about these two candidates. And if you want Biden over Trump, well, you know, all the shit that Lane is talking about is probably has a better chance of happening, in my opinion, under him. And that's something I'm trying to get to my Democratic friends who I do have in California. It's like, hey, man, I know Trump is an egotistical narcissist and he's crazy, but I don't think the outcome is as bad as what Biden's going to get you.
Obviously. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's just my theory on it. And I try to portray that to them all the time. And they're starting to pick it up because guess what? Their paychecks aren't really helping them these days. Yeah. And then they're starting to understand, dude, this sucks. And not only that, but in California, we're giving away, I forgot what it was. Robert Ellis hit me up today, dude. He texted me. I'll read what he said. It's pretty funny. He said, just looking at the TV and it says that your state is $31.5 billion in debt. Do you think you could arrange a couple of bake sales at your church? Also, if they do the reparations thing, that's going to be $800 million more. So I'm afraid your taxes are going up, buddy. And like, me and him talked, and I was like, I don't think the ladies in California can bake enough goods to come up with that kind of fundraiser. That's what I said. And then I said, and if they do the reparations, I may have to paint myself black and go to the nearest collections to receive that check. Yeah. Because we're coming up with some asinine numbers to give out to, if you're going to give out money to anybody, give it to the Mexicans, like, especially in California, like we bought California, from Mexico. I think there was definitely no battle.
No, I don't know how it worked. And I don't know the divisions of the state, to be honest with you.
But we bought it.
I don't know if we the whole it. State was, the Mexico was never in charge of all of California.
Yeah. Have you seen Zorro?
Yeah.
the OG, yeah. Yeah. That's the OG California right there. Well, all right, dude. I mean, it's up in the air. You just like you and I, we could talk all day and night about it, but I guess, who would you take, or what's your thoughts on if Trump will actually win in 2024?
Well, I don't know. It's possible. You throw him and Biden against each other, anything could happen. I still don't want him to be the Republican nominee, and I don't think that we should be crowning him as a Republican nominee at this point anyway. I think that's kind of insane. I think he was very well suited for a specific moment in time, and I think he should probably, if I don't want him to be the Republican nominee. If he is, I'll vote for him, sure. Is he a better alternative than Biden? There's absolutely no question. Did I like a lot of his policies? Yes. But since 2018, what has he really done? And what are his plans? He's not saying anything. What are his plans? He's not saying. During the CNN town hall, it was awesome. It was fun. It was great to see him wreck her. But what did he say he was going to do? He didn't have to answer any questions that Republicans cared about. And I don't think he has any plans. He just keeps talking about the election. No, nobody cares anymore about the election. If the election was stolen, what are you going to do to stop it from happening next time? What's your solution there? He isn't giving solutions on anything. All he does is get involved in, and do I think the lawsuit against him was fair? No. I definitely think that lady was crazy, for sure. I think there is a political witch hunt out to get him, for sure. But at the same time, while he is getting in fights with CNN on Truth Social and being hilarious, Ron DeSantis is running the most effective state that has existed in the 21st century. And he is doing things in the culture that are good. His economy is phenomenal. He has real answers on Ukraine and Russia, on geopolitics. He has met with leaders of South Korea and Japan to secure investment into his state. He is such a better choice to run the country than Donald Trump. It is not even close. And if Republicans are so gung-ho on wanting to wreck the libs because they think what Trump does is funny and we lose, we deserve it. We should, because DeSantis is every good Trump policy that you want without the insanity, without the craziness, without the lack of focus. And he's actually done things. And he's doing things. He's banning on the culture issue. He is taking care of the trans issue in sports, about LGBT in schools, with the corporations. He's handled Disney, with the economy. They have one of the best, if not the best economy of all the states in the entire country. People are moving there because they want to be there because he runs a good system. He was in the military, so he understands that. He is a strong family man with a wife and kids, and he embodies what you would really want an American president to. But we're so stuck on wanting Trump to own the libs that we're probably going to nominate him again, and that would be a huge mistake, because then it's 50-50. I think if DeSantis versus Biden, I think it's so clear-cut in competency.
Yeah.
And I also don't want a president that's in their 80s. Why not get a guy that's in their 40s, that's youthful, that has new visions, that has a proven track record, that has been in the military? I don't get it. I don't understand why this segment of the right is so stuck on Trump. I don't get it.
I think Trump did a good job of exposing a lot of things during his presidency that a lot of the American people
remember
didn't
who put Anthony Fauci in charge, right?
Trump.
Mm. Remember and who then, got mad at Ron DeSantis when he opened up his state? Trump.
I think DeSantis was actually down in the polls whenever he was running for governor of Florida, and then Trump endorsed him, and then bam, he shot.
Sure, that's a good endorsement. That's great.
Clearly,
but as soon as Trump started seeing DeSantis, people liked him, he immediately tried to cut his legs out from underneath him. During COVID, DeSantis like, we're opening back up, and Trump goes, he said that's a bad decision. He said the same thing about the governor in Georgia. All these governors that Trump has attacked, like the Georgia governor, like the Florida governor, they got elected by huge margins in states, and especially in Georgia. Trump lost Georgia, and the Republican governor won by 10 points. Because he's an effective governor, because he's normal. We needed that crazy for a little bit. I think we really did, to expose the Obama years. We need normalcy now.
Yeah, we need policy now, and back to good policy.
Yes.
And a competent, non-super egotistical person to come in and really, hopefully, I mean, this is me being hopeful. Like, hopefully clean up what's been going on. Like you said, that's a great analogy to just show what he's done in Florida. Like, if he could do that to the nation, that'd be incredible.
And again, I'm not a Trump hater. I like him for a lot of reasons, and I would happily vote for him if he's the nominee.
But we're down to 50-50, though.
That's what
we're
I mean. It's a crapshoot.
It's him. It's not a landslide like DeSantis would be. When is the due date for these people to say when they're going to
run? I think if DeSantis is going to be making an announcement on that pretty soon, because he said he was going to wait till the end of the Florida legislative session, which I believe was this week. I think it just ended, or it ends this upcoming week. So we should be expecting something from him soon. He was in Iowa this week, today, and Iowa is like one of the first places that people want to campaign because it's kind of a good bellwether. So I foresee that he would announce a run. The only thing I really dread is that they go against each other and they tear each other down, or that and then we just kill ourselves from the inside. But
I had a podcaster on, and he said, you know, it's in our sayings: united we stand, divided we fall. And that's really stuck with me.
Yeah.
Like, and even with my friends who don't think the way I think, don't believe in the same political whatever politics that I think. The number one thing that pops in my head is, hey man, but divided we fall. So like, try to be reasonable, try to understand their views, then give them yours. Keep the argumenting down. Try to understand, even with a lot of the stuff going on, I'm trying to understand people, and it's hard. It's very hard, but I think it's what we have to do.
You have to do
in general.
I think,
or else divided we will
fall. I mean, generally most Americans don't even identify with either political party. I think it's 25-25. So there's so many people in the middle that we can reach by just being normal, because Republican policies are better. Always. Just be normal. Just try to reach groups and try to have conversations. Don't call people stupid because they disagree with you right away. There are stupid people that are not worthy of your time of discussion, for sure. Somebody with pink hair that is yelling at you and throwing paint on you because they think you're a trans, but there's no reason to talk to them. They're lost. But the person that's like, well, I voted Joe Biden because I think, you know, he's just kind of an old man and Trump said these things about women. You talk to that person. You have a conversation with them.
You have firsthand knowledge of this doing a lot of big YouTube videos where you are the interviewer going into, did you go into what was it? What are those things that like trans come to like a place and they do like a drag show?
Oh, the child drag show. It was like drag queens and stuff like that. And like most of the people you talk there, they don't even understand what's going on. They're not bad people. They never just haven't thought about it. Because so many people, especially women, and this is a great thing about women, they have this maternal instinct to want to protect, right? And so they want to make sure everyone's treated equally. And that's great, but that is being taken advantage of by certain groups. Just talk to these people, and I think a lot of them can be convinced, right? And maybe there's things that we think we know that are not correct too that we could probably have a new perspective on. I obviously think that the track record of Republican policy or conservative policy is much healthier and much better for the country. But I think there's certain things that the right does that are probably not great ideas. Like, I think the idea, and I won't get too into this, but of free markets completely, like, just let the free market do whatever it's going to do. I don't think that's probably a great idea, right? You do need to have programs for people that can't succeed within that, people with disabilities that really, you know, and that wouldn't, the people with disabilities would never, probably not have had those gains without certain groups from the left pushing for them. And that's fine, right? American government's about compromise. But I don't know, just try to reach across and talk to people, because if all we're trying to do is own them, own the libs, okay, well then we saw how that worked in the last election.
Yeah.
Tell me what you're going to do to make their life better. Why is the economy going to be better for them? Why are Republican policies better for African Americans? Why are they better for Asian Americans? Explain these things, right? Don't call them dumb for voting for Democrats. Explain why it would be smart to vote for Republicans.
Touche, my man. Touche. We could get into Twitter and the new CFO or whatever, and we could do all that, or we could call it quits. But regardless, you kind of came with some heat today, bro.
What do you want to do? Are you done, or do you want to talk about it?
Yeah, let's bring it up. I'm a strong believer that the World Economic Forum is bad. Their policies and what they implement is just kind of like they want this new world order, whatever the hell Klaus Schwab says, and he wants transhumanism, basically kind of to go into the future more on the lines of like the Terminator or something. I don't know. They just are all about it, and they want these small smart cities and Chevy in it and all this stuff. And you got Elon Musk, who took over Twitter, and now he hired a new CFO who's a big component of the World Economic Forum. And it's like, wait, I thought you were a hero, Elon. Like, what are you doing dragging her into it? And so, I mean, it's just, you look at these things and you see these people and their track record and you question things. And that's kind of where I was at, and I was talking to you about it earlier today. And just so people know, Davos isn't a group, it's actually a city.
Yeah.
Lane told me that today. But what are your thoughts on him hiring the World Economic, like a high up? I don't know.
So
you have a different perspective than I do.
I mean, I don't love to see that on her resume. What I've seen Elon saying so far is that he doesn't really intend to give her any kind of creative control. But the good thing that when Elon took over Twitter, he said something that made some people mad, but I liked it. He said, if the farthest 10% on the right hate me and the farthest 10% on the left hate me, that I've made a good platform. And I completely agree with that. I think that's great. And with this lady, you're probably seeing all your friends, and I saw it too, she's part of the WF, she's evil. She's, you know, Klaus Schwab's puppet. The left hates this woman too, like with a passion. They think she's MAGA because she was in Trump's administration. Because she interacts with a lot of right-wing figures on Twitter. She likes a lot of right-wing stuff. Go back through her likes on Twitter and see what she has interacted with. It's pretty much exclusively right-wing content. But then she also kind of tried to advance like women in the workplace and diversity in the workplace, which is concerning. So she's hated by both sides. But the point is, she's being brought in my opinion, to make Twitter friendly for advertisers, to the extent that she can, because she's the advertising head at NBC Universal. So she manages like hundreds of billions worth of dollars in ad revenue. I could be, I'm making that number up, but it's in the billions, right? So she's very good at what she does about getting companies to spend ad money where she wants it. And that's what Twitter wants to do, because they want to turn it into a place where you can make money. They want to make it a new YouTube. I'm pretty sure that he wants to make it the platform for video, for everything.
Podcast. Yeah.
Right. I think that's what he wants to do.
I thought that, yeah, I think it's pretty cool.
And so he's, from what I can tell from him, even after the, look at his tweets that he has been putting out. I do trust the guy. I really do. I don't know why. I don't have a great explanation for it. He just seems very sincere in everything he says. That's just my intuition. I don't have insider information. I don't. But if you look at what he said, it seems that he's not giving her creative control over content at all. He's still going to be the owner of the company, so he has the final say on everything. Now, is there kind of questions if she's going to push on him to make things more advertiser friendly? Maybe, sure. Sure, yeah. That's a valid concern, but he said at the end of the day, free speech is the number one consideration. He just said this, it's the only consideration that matters. So I have no reason to not believe him, because everything he's done with Twitter so far, I'm a huge fan of. Other than note, like, I don't seem to get any engagement with my tweets anymore, but I wasn't really getting that much engagement to begin with. I'm not like a super popular tweeter. But
it's weird how engagement works, because like, you have these really weirdos that have millions of views, and I'm like, bro, you're not nearly as smart or present it in a way that is like, I don't know. I'm not that great at it either, but you are. And so it's like, how's Lane's tweet on why China and Taiwan would be a bad issue? Like, how is that not blown up compared to like some that I've seen? And I'm like, okay, whatever.
Yeah. So other than that, I don't have, that's weird. Every other decision he's made, I really enjoy it. I like Twitter better. It's more fun. There's more views. It's great. So I have, from everything he's done so far, is everything he said he was going to do. So I have no reason to disbelieve him. And so I'm not really that worried about it. I'm not freaking out. I don't love the World Economic Forum Association, because it is a cesspool of people. But at the same time, I also know, is it better to be involved in those things or to disengage from those things, right? I don't know. Like, if someone offered me a position at the World Economic Forum that said, hey, can you come in and advise on this? Is it better for me to ignore it and hope it goes away, or to go in there and see if I can make a change? I don't know. I'm not saying that's what she did. I'm just saying involvement with an organization doesn't inherently mean that is your share every ideology. Part of the ideology. Maybe.
Touche. No, that's a great point. No, it really is. That's a great point. Just because I work for a company too doesn't mean that I am their decisions. Right. That doesn't fully represent me. Yeah, exactly.
So we'll see. Right. I say we just kind of have tempered expectations and hold our breath a little bit here, because I think she was probably brought in just to increase ad revenue, and she seems to be very good at that. And as long as Elon has the final say, I don't particularly worry. I could be proven wrong, but I'm not.
Well, who knows, man? We shall see. Yep. We shall see. Lane Kendall, you came, you saw, you destroyed. You are a monster. That's why I love having you on. Everybody will learn a thing or two from anytime you're on my podcast. It's like, I listen to everybody, dude. And then the stuff you spew at me, I'm like, that's a great perspective. Like, and you could tell it's research. So you're doing a great job, dude. You crushed. My wife just texted me. She's like, it's time. So I was like, okay. It is kind of late for Luna to go to bed.
Well, tell Christina thank you for, you know, letting me steal a couple hours.
Oh, yeah. No, dude. Thank you so much for coming on. Listeners, freaking like, subscribe. Look up Lane Kendall on Twitter, too, if you want to follow a great account on Twitter. Because that guy, he just has all the goods. But Lane, I love you to death. And everybody else, peace out.
Peace. Uh-huh, yeah!